Our next report tonight grows out of months of investigation into suspicious deaths at a drug treatment center. It's run by Narconon. If you've seen our previous reporting, then you know Narconon has strong ties to the Church of Scientology. Many patients say the program has helped them with their addictions, but Harry Smith's reporting prompted two former Narconon executives to step out of the shadows. Tonight they join Harry to share their experiences.
If you're about to send one of your loved ones to Narconon Arrowhead, should you be concerned for their safety?
Absolutely. I would be concerned. I personally would never recommend to anybody that they should send their loved one to Narconon.
This is Lucas Catton, the former president of Narconon Arrowhead, a drug rehabilitation center located in a remote area of Oklahoma. Last year, we reported on three young people who died there within 9 months.
Seems like it was just yesterday.
Shirley Gillum's son, Gabriel, died at Narconon in October 2011. The cause of death could not be determined.
Did you feel like they were completely forthcoming with you on the phone in terms of who they were,
no,
what their procedures were?
No.
Gillum says she is filled with sorrow and regret about sending Gabriel to Narconon.
I just wished that I had not taken him there. I wished that with everything inside me.
Catton and his former colleague Eric Tenorio, both executives who cut ties with Narconon 3 years ago, say though no one died on their watch, they feel compelled to speak out about what they say are the program's failings.
We did the story last summer of three different young people who died at Arrowhead. Did you see the story?
I did. And I felt terrible about it. Could have been prevented. Absolutely every single one of those deaths. If those families would have gotten the truth about what they were getting into, they would have absolutely not have sent their families there. And I apologize, you know.
Narconon. And what were they getting into? Catton and Tenorio say a crash course in Scientology. Patients are called students, and they study a series of eight books based on the writings of Scientology founder L. Ron Hubbard.
They can confront their own problems and solve their own problems and so bring themselves up by their own bootstraps.
Narconon promotes itself as a non-medical rehabilitation program. Its methods include 5 hours a day in a sauna for 30 straight days and mega doses of the vitamin niacin, all part of a larger system of life skills training that Narconon says has helped tens of thousands lead drug-free lives.
You were taught, in Hubbard's language, that you are the expert in mental health.
This is Lucas Catton as a young man. He arrived at Narconon as a patient in 1998 when he was 20 years old. His parents were concerned he was drinking too much. He got a job there as a counselor in 2000 and quickly worked his way up to president. At the time, and for years afterwards, he believed the program was helpful and gave this 2009 testimonial to the Church of Scientology.
There is not a more comprehensive rehabilitation program available than Narconon.
In this process, while you were at Narconon, did you become a Scientologist?
I did. I became a full-fledged Scientologist, absolutely. I dedicated all of my time, life, money, everything was dedicated toward the purpose of advancing Scientology's aims. That is what you're doing at Narconon, is you're advancing the aims of Scientology.
From your perspective, and you were the president of Narconon Arrowhead, does the Church of Scientology use Narconon as a way to recruit new members?
Absolutely it does.
The other main objective of Narconon, Catton says, was to pull in millions of dollars in revenue. The 3 to 6 month program cost $30,000 per patient.
So therefore you're willing to either lie to them or misrepresent who you are or take people who aren't really qualified, anything to bring in the money to keep the facility going week after week after week.
In a statement to NBC News, the Church of Scientology said the cost of Narconon is comparable to other addiction treatment programs. Eric Tenorio also came to Narconon as a patient in 1996. Upon completing the program, he, like Catton, got hired on as staff. He, too, became a Scientologist and gave this 2008 testimonial to the church.
There's no way that I would have got to the point where I am right now if it wasn't for the Narconon program.
He worked his way up the ladder at Arrowhead and in 2004 took a position as executive director at Narconon's Freedom Center in Michigan.
If you're on the staff at Narconon, beyond the teachings of L. Ron Hubbard, is there any instruction whatsoever in terms of your dealing with people who are addicted to drugs and alcohol?
None.
Zero.
Zero.
Tenorio showed us official-looking certificates he received as a quote-unquote certified alcohol and drug counselor in Michigan. They came from an organization called the PITA Group, run by a Narconon Arrowhead contractor.
That's the kind of thing you got?
That's, yeah. It's got a nice seal on it to make it look very official.
Mm-hmm.
You can stick it on your wall, and any unsuspecting public will be none the wiser.
What did you do to get this?
Wrote him a check.
That's it?
That's it.
No course?
No course. No tests. No oversight.
No curriculum?
No, nothing.
But it feels like fraud.
It is fraud. It's absolutely fraud.
The PITA Group denies Tenorio's assertions and says it requires 20 hours of training and 2 years of experience to obtain a certificate.
Do you blame Narconon for your daughter's death?
Absolutely.
Robert Murphy's daughter, Stacy, died of an overdose inside Narconon Arrowhead last July. He and the families of the other deceased have sued Narconon. The program denied wrongdoing in any of the deaths. Murphy says the advertised success rate of 75% is what drew them to Narconon.
You're thinking this might be the answer.
Oh, yeah, because they tout such high success rate.
Tenorio and Catton say that number is a complete fabrication.
And it's well known internally that they cannot produce that success rate.
They know inside.
Absolutely, they know.
Narconon says it stands by its statistics. Catton stepped down as president in 2004, but stayed close to the program. For the next 5 years, he worked as a contractor, selling Narconon to desperate relatives of drug addicts from around the country, all looking for help on the Internet with no indication the sites they were viewing might lead them to Narconon.
I had a series of websites that were non-branded, like generic websites for people to look for drug treatment and rehab help.
So if I went on the Internet looking for drug treatment, I'd land on one of your sites?
Land on one of my sites, pick up the phone, call. Either myself or somebody who I employed would answer the phone or respond to your email and start taking down information, asking pertinent questions, listening for a few key things, whether or not you had money, whether or not you had some type of insurance. They really teach you to listen for, and even use the term, listen for the money.
Listen for the money.
Listen for the money.
Catton says he referred those who could afford it to Narconon. The rest, he says, he referred elsewhere. He made a 10% commission, or $3,000, on every person who went to a Narconon facility.
Did you make pretty good money doing this?
I did. Yeah, I used to.
In a given year? How much?
Easily $150,000, $200,000.
Do you think Narconon preys on vulnerable people?
I absolutely believe Narconon preys on vulnerable people. That's part of the sales techniques. One of the techniques that they do is called finding your ruin. And they teach people who are on the phone with families, find out what are the biggest problems in their lives. What is the thing that they're most afraid of is going to happen? And you hit that over and over and over again until they break down and go, oh my gosh, we have to do something. And you're there to tell them, well, we have the answer.
And where are the regulators, you ask? Catton says as president of Narconon Arrowhead, he helped Narconon take advantage of loopholes in Oklahoma state law to avoid any kind of meaningful regulation by the state.
Does the state have a kind of a hands-off policy when it comes to that facility?
Absolutely, they have a hands-off policy. They don't know how to handle it. The state, unfortunately, has not done their job.
The state regulatory agency says Narconon Arrowhead is currently certified to provide non-medical detoxification services and that an investigation into the deaths is ongoing. Catton says he started to question Narconon and Scientology after he began to look into unfavorable reports about the church in 2010. He says when he started to question church authorities, he was excommunicated. Tenorio stopped working for Narconon in 2010 after tiring of what he calls fraud and poor management, and leaving Narconon essentially ended his connection with the church. Both men say they are ashamed of their involvement with Narconon and Scientology.
Well, it's definitely embarrassing. You know, I don't go around telling people that I meet that, oh yeah, I used to be in a cult. You know,
I used to be in a cult.
Yeah, because I don't like to say, yeah, I wasted this time. doing this activity that I thought was right, when in actual fact it's just pseudoscience. Or, you know, it's this guy selling snake oil.
Narconon and Church of Scientology officials declined our request for on-camera interviews. But in statements, both organizations said that Narconon is not a source of recruitment for the church, and said only a very small percentage of patients join Scientology. In an email to NBC News, Narconon Arrowhead CEO Gary Smith said, of Narconon Arrowhead's current staff, approximately 25% are Scientologists. He said Narconon's chief concern is to salvage people from the ravages of drug addiction, and nothing in the procedures puts money before helping the person who is suffering. CEO Smith also said Catton has ties to anti-Scientology activists.
We'll be in communication with Narconon, and the first thing we're going to hear, you guys are discredited, you're out to destroy Narconon, you're not to be trusted.
Right.
To which you would say what?
For me personally, I think it's quite the opposite. Why would I incriminate myself? Why would I give up my certifications? Why would I do all these things? It's purely so that the truth can come out, so that people can stop hurting, so that people can stop dying, and so that there can be full transparency.
They go to great lengths at quieting people. They're not going to do that with me. I'm going to tell the truth, and there's nothing they can say or do to stop that.
Harry Smith with the follow-up tonight on Narconon, and something tells me there will be more on this topic.